I've previously explored towns up north in Sweden, but I decided to make a road trip to the south as well. I'll be traveling from Stockholm through the district of Östergötland, onwards to Småland, Halland, Skåne and the very southern tip of Sweden, and then up again a different route. Come on, let's explore the southern towns of Sweden! I'm gonna start things off here in the town of Linköping. Linköping is a town in Östergötland, and that means that people speak really funny here. The place where Linköping is located has been inhabited since the Bronze Age, and there are lots of Viking remnants here as well. Since the 1100s, Linköping has been the central religious town in the district of Östergötland. Around 115,000 people live in the city today, and there are many tech companies here, including some big ones like Saab and Ericsson. The Air Force has had a base here for a long time, and there's an Air Force museum as well. Linköping Cathedral is probably the best known feature of the city. There's been a church here since the 12th century, but it's been refurbished and remodeled and renovated so many times. But I think it's looked like this since the 1700s. The second most famous landmark of Linköping, Busses Glassbar. Anyway, that's enough of Linköping. Let's move on. The county of Gränna and Visingsö lies next to Vättern, Sweden's deepest lake, which means that it's bloody cold. I'm not gonna go swimming there. Gränna is famous for the twirled peppermint candy they make here, if you're into stuff like that. You can go inside and see how they make the candy. It's really popular with the kids. And me. The town of Värnamo used to be a market town and a thing town in medieval times. Around 20,000 people live here, and it's an industrial town. 35% of all the jobs come from the industry. There are a few interesting places to visit here. A bit north of town you can find Stenar and National Park, but I'm not gonna go there. The weather is so dodgy today. And just outside of town there's a Wild West theme park called High Chaparral. By the way, it's almost impossible to spell chaparral. How many P's and R's and L's are there? Some semi-famous people come from Värnamo, a couple of football players, but mostly politicians. What's with this town and politics? Anyway, let's move on. Welcome to the small town of Ljungby. Actually, I have nothing to say about this place. I'm just filling up gas. So, let's move on. This is Helsingborg, and Helsingborg is Skåne's second biggest city, with just over 100,000 inhabitants. It's located at a point where Denmark and Sweden almost meet, so it's been an important strategic location since ancient times. That's Denmark over there. Let's wave to the Danes. This city used to belong to Denmark for a long time. In fact, all of Skåne used to belong to Denmark. And that's why people in Skåne sound like they have half-chewed potatoes in their mouths when they're trying to speak. I'm glancing around to see if I'm gonna be beaten up now. That's compared with the Danish, who sound like they have huge raw potatoes stuffed in their mouths. After the peace at Roskilde in 1658, Helsingborg became Swedish. And we have cursed King Carl X for that ever since. Nah, I'm just kidding. Helsingborg is a lovely city actually, full of lush green parks and historical monuments. There's cultural events, nightlife, sporting events. In fact, the city often punches above its own weight class when it comes to offering things to do. The next town I'm gonna visit after this one has a bit more controversy surrounding it though. Welcome to Malmö, Sweden's third biggest city with more than 300,000 inhabitants, which is still pretty small compared to many other cities, but we're proud of what we've got, okay? Apparently, these people make a distinction if you were born in Malmö or if you moved here. If you're born here, then you're a Malmöit. If you moved here, then you're a Malmöbo. Yeah, I'm just gonna roll my eyes a little bit at that. Aw, is that pop cross-eyed? The history of Malmö starts in the 1100s, but it was a very small village back then. It expanded in the 1300s, mostly due to fishing. Just like Helsingborg, Malmö was under Danish rule up until 1658, when it became Swedish. But Sweden pretty much forgot about Malmö for a while after that. It wasn't until the end of the 1700s, when a proper harbor was built in Malmö, that it started to grow into a decently sized town. If there's one thing people in Sweden often hear about Malmö, it's that it's a dangerous place. One area typically mentioned is Rosengård, the Rose Garden, which is often classified as a no-go zone. Gunshots, gang violence, unemployment, Rosengård has it all. But then again, this is Sweden, so even a no-go zone isn't that bad. But yeah, I guess I'm not gonna leave my car unlocked there. But let's end on a positive note. Malmö is actually home to two of the seven wonders of Sweden. Good work, Malmö! This is Smygehuk, the southernmost point in Sweden, at the very southern tip. Oh, bloody hell. There's a lot of waves crashing in. I hope I'm not gonna be... Oh, fuck! Denmark is over there. Exciting, isn't it? So now I've been at the southern point of Sweden. I haven't been to the northern point yet, though. I've been pretty far up north, but not all the way there. Maybe one of these days I need to travel up there. Beware of snakes, apparently. You see any snakes in the grass? No snakes so far? Aw, too bad. Okay, let's move on to a slightly less windy place. Or actually, I have no idea how windy it's gonna be, but let's move on. Kåseberga is a quaint little town located by the sea, not unlike many others in Skåne. But there's something special about this town. At the top of this hill I will find Ale stenar, the biggest stone ship formation in Sweden. Ale stenar are also called hedstenar locally, but they believe that the original name could have been Asalås stenar, which means the rocks on that big hill. People often call monuments like these Viking Age, but they're actually from the Vendel Age before the Viking Age. But I'm geeking out more about that in a separate video, so I'm not gonna bore you too much with all the details. Fun fact, this place is not just popular with tourists, it's also popular with neo-pagans who have performed Old Norse blood sacrifices and Wiccan solstice rituals here. The view here really is something special. Wow, what a place! This is the town of Kristianstad. I don't really have all that much to say about it because I wasn't planning on visiting here. But I do know that it has 40,000 inhabitants and it was founded by the Danish King Christian IV. From the beginning, this was a fortified town because King Christian wanted this to be a defensive town against the evil Swedes. Well, sucks to be him since all of Skåne became Swedish in 1658. I don't think I've been here before, but it's actually quite a gorgeous little town, full of nice architecture. I'm pleasantly surprised. Although the nightlife maybe leaves a little bit to be desired, this is probably all the action it gets on a Saturday night. What? Danish sausages in Sweden? I was just driving past the town of Älmhult and I realized I have to make a quick stop here. Cause this is the place where the first IKEA store opened in 1958. They still have an IKEA store in Elmhult, but they also have an IKEA hotel, an IKEA restaurant, and an IKEA museum. So I'm just gonna have a quick look here. And yes, you can get Swedish meatballs at the restaurants, or as we call them, meatballs. Växjö in Småland has had city privileges since 1342, and it's also been a university town since 1999. Around 70,000 people live here, and it's famous both nationally and internationally for its sports teams. There's the football and hockey teams, for example. The hockey team is called Lakers, which is a bloody silly name, trying to sound like American teams. The university is also quite renowned and has grown a lot since the start. I'm mentioning both the sports and the university to placate my sister and her husband, otherwise they won't let me try their homemade beer. I'm guessing you guys have heard of Carl von Linné, or Carl Linnaeus as he is called abroad sometimes. You know, the guy who classified plants and animals and set Latin names to things? He actually went to high school here. In fact, the same high school as I went to, although I was 270 years later. And I guess maybe he did a few more impressive things than I have. There's actually a few cool things to do around here, so let me show you a few clips from what you can see and do around Växjö. Helsingborg Castle started to be built in 1897 and stood finished at 1900 exactly. It was built by the Count Fredrik Bonde, which actually means Fredrik Farmer. Swedish nobility names are pretty weird. The castle was actually a late wedding gift to his wife Anna. The small town of Hultsfred has been known for two things and two things alone. Firstly, it's been a railway connection point, so many people have traveled through here. And secondly, it's been the location of Sweden's biggest open-air music festival back in the olden days. The festival took place here every year between 1986 and 2012. I think I was here the first time in 1996. Good old times, hitchhiking to the festival and then sneaking in because I was a poor bastard. Not even a one-star vagabond back then. Now it's just a forgotten little town that I'm just mentioning because it was a convenient place to stop for the night. This is the town of Vimmerby, and all you need to know about this place is that it's the hometown of Astrid Lindgren, the author. You don't know who Astrid Lindgren is? Shame on you, shame on you. Here you can also find Astrid Lindgren's Värld, a theme park dedicated to her stories and characters. It's an adorable place. Söderköping was a very important town in the 12 and 1300s AD. It was a central trading point and a religious center as well. However, it was occupied by Danish troops in 1517 and then completely destroyed in 1567. It got a little bit of a boost with the building of Söderköping Brunn, a place that's now a conference center, and with the building of Göta Canal that runs through this town. But the one thing Söderköping is most famous for these days is the ice cream restaurant Smultronstället. Smultronstället literally means the wild strawberry place, but it's a Swedish idiom, and the real meaning is more like a hidden favorite place or a secret hideaway. But as you can see, it's not very secret and not very hidden. I was gonna end my trip around the south of Sweden with a lovely ice cream creation from this place, but Look at that queue. It starts there and it continues all the way around the corner and onwards forever. Well, that's about it for my little trip. Feel free to laugh at my misfortune, because I'm not getting any ice cream. Like and subscribe, but most importantly, have a great day.